Hey, look, the COP. So for anyone who has only been paying attention to politics for the last 5-6 years, you may not even be aware who the COP is. You may not know that this is a political party in Trinidad and Tobago, but it is. The COP, the Congress of the People, they were once the third party of Trinidad and Tobago. They were a viable third option. People looked at them as being possibly another option to turn to away from the two main parties. You know, that's always something. Well, that's a main meeting point on Trinidad's political landscape. You know, I don't think it's just Trinidad. It's pretty much any democracy, any country that has parties, it usually devolves into a two-party system, the first past the post system. That's our voting style. It usually just ends up in a two-party system for obvious reasons. So let's say there are three parties. There's the Black Party, there's the White Party, and there's the Grey Party. And let's say that I prefer the White Party for whatever reason, and I vote for the White Party. And in that election, when I voted for the White Party, the Black Party won. But the Grey Party came second. In the next election, my vote that I voted for that White Party that came last, I'm going to find that to be a wasteful vote. And the Grey Party may be closer to my beliefs than the Black Party actually is. So I'm going to sacrifice voting for that White Party, and I'll vote for the Grey Party. And similarly, if the same thing was happening to another group on the Black side, they would do the same thing. And that's why usually in our style of voting system, it's nearly inevitable that it becomes a two-party system. It's understandable why. It's part of human nature in a sense. But the third party can give another option outside of that two-horse race that we got accustomed to in Trinidad and many other countries got accustomed to. You see, the problem with a two-horse race is it kills the idea of democracy. If democracy is me choosing who I want to lead me, and the only options are the two options that my ruling class presents before me, then they aren't really giving me options. So the third party hopefully gives an outlet to that sentiment and gives more of an anti-establishment slant and lean to the focus on it. And the COP was offering that at one point in time. They were a viable option for that. The COP was formed out of the UNC, as many opposition parties are formed in Trinidad and Tobago. They're formed out of the main opposition party. Somebody or some group of people within the party become disenchanted with the direction the party is going in, and they leave. And that's how the COP was formed. And for a while, they actually provided, as I said, that third option, and they built up so much momentum in the 2007 election in Trinidad and Tobago. They got the most votes a third party ever got in the history of Trinidad and Tobago. And they got no seats though. The way how the election system works, they got a lot of votes, but no seats, which I guess disappointed them greatly. But that was a promising sign. I think they should have gone it alone, and by the next election, they may have been in a position to actually have won some seats and be in the challenge to be inside of the parliament. But they didn't choose that option. In the next election after 2007, there was a shorter election called in 2010, and the COP joined their forces with Kamla Prasad Bisesa and the UNC, forming the People's Partnership Government, which may, in my opinion, be one of the most, and I'm choosing my words carefully, one of the most blatantly corrupt administrations this country has ever seen. Not necessarily corrupt, because there's really and truly no way for me to know which was the most corrupt administration. There's no way I could know where all those billions passed, and a lot of billions passed. But during the People's Partnership administration, it could have been a combination of factors. I could excuse them a bit, because it could have also been the fact that social media was blowing up and the ease of technology and information was blowing up. But the partnership, nearly every week there was some breaking news of some blatant kind of corruption, some naked corruption within that administration and that government. Several members of the partnership left. the MSG, the Movement for Social Justice, they said they couldn't handle the level of corruption that they were witnessing, and they left. They were a labor union-based party formed from some labor union leaders. The leader of another section in the partnership, McCandle Daga, he is now passed. He was quoted as saying he has never seen such corruption in his life. But to his discredit, he remained in the administration, but I would not like to necessarily speak ill of the dead. The COP, however, never said anything much, and they remained a part of the partnership right till the end, with along with their leader at that time. If you heard me in a previous video speak about Axe the Tax and a certain politician who may have had property in another country while they may be looking to cut property taxes in ours, well, yes, that guy. And he remained with the partnership straight till the end, right as their administration came to an end. In the next election, he left the COP and he left politics. I find that kind of behavior very suspicious. You came into power, you were part of an administration that already got accused of so much corruption. You were someone who professed to have so much visions for the future and the furtherance of our country. But as soon as your administration is deposed from power, you disappear from the political landscape. Well, it could be that the stress of it all just became too much and he'd like to return to a more normal life, but I just find some of those actions slightly suspicious. But the COP is back in the landscape and they are calling for a reduction in salaries from the Prime Minister and the opposition leader. They must take a pay cut. In a statement on Thursday, COP Chairman Lonsdale Williams said Dr. Rowley Prasad Bisesa and other MPs should take pay cuts like many of our citizens have been forced to until we are in a better position to share in the wealth which can undoubtedly be created with creative and innovative approaches. Many people have developed a shared sense of apathy, he said, because they know that our leaders will simply ride out the current storm and not deal directly with the problems at hand, Williams added. This can lead to frustration, despair, and collective depression that comes out of hopeless feeling of a squandered trust. According to the 98 report of the Salary Review Commission, they are the body that is supposed to be independent of the government, that reviews the government salary, that reviews the salary of the people, of the workers in parliament, and says the allotment their salary is supposed to be at. Rowley and Prasad Bisesa receive salaries of 48,000 and 23,800 respectively. Cabinet ministers, non-cabinet ministers, ordinary MPs of the House of Representatives who are not ministers or parliamentary secretaries, and senators receive salaries of 33,000, 27,000, 14,000 and 10,500 respectively. Last October, Rowley said there were no plans to cut the salaries of government officials or members of the House of Representatives. He said, those of us who genuinely serve the public and those of us who genuinely share what we earn with those we represent and those we don't represent, we don't have a problem. And you know what I have a problem with? I have a problem with the song, like, they are the only ones genuinely serving the public. I urge some of you to wake up early some morning, because a lot of the garbage trucks, the rubbish trucks that pick up the garbage from your street corner, they pass really early in the morning, and observe them at 4:30. This week, there was a group of them at 4:30 in the morning, during one of those rainy mornings when everyone would be pulling their covers, tightly looking to snuggle up with whatever they could in their bed. And there were a group of men picking up garbage on the street corner in rain at 4:30 a.m. Can you tell me, realistically, with a straight face, that they aren't due the same thing that someone who is making decisions as the Prime Minister would be due? What could there possibly be to make that have such an imbalance? So, you see, what my problem is, when someone tells me that this is what is due to the parliamentarians, I like to think what they aren't saying in that. If 48,000, plus the perks of the tax exemptions, really and truly the 48,000 isn't even my main grievance. You see those 100,000 tax exemptions that they're just piling up and collecting cars with? That's one of my main grievances. And you see that they get and that they say they're entitled to? By you saying you're entitled to that, then the people whose salaries were cut, the people who aren't getting anything are you saying that they aren't entitled to anything? And if you're saying, well, they're entitled to something, it's just unfortunate that they can't get it now. Why should it be unfortunate for them, but it shouldn't be unfortunate for you? Is misfortune only supposed to go in one direction? Is the fortune only supposed to favor the politician, those in charge? So I am agreeing with the COP. Maybe they should have had some courage way back since 2010, but I'm agreeing with them now. I think those in charge should, even if just for the symbolic nature of it, do that. Because many other people are suffering and they can look at you and see what you're doing. And that imbalance, as people keep warning about, is not a recipe for stability in our country. And we're seeing the effects continue. An article from just today again, big restaurants close in Coover. The Coover Point Leasers Chamber of Commerce is appealing to landlords to give commercial tenants a chance. The appeal was made by the president of the CPLCC, Mukesh Ram Singh, as he fielded questions from Guardian Media yesterday at the chamber's offices at Camden, Coover. This came as one of the larger restaurants in Coover, their owner, announced that they will be closing permanently. Sham Ram Kisoon, the owner and manager of Jay-Z's restaurant on the southern main road, Coover, said he has no choice but to fold operations and sell his business. Ram Kisoon said the property and investment had cost him $25 million and he hoped to get around $15 to $17 million for the property if the property is sold. Ram Kisoon said he is not happy with the way the food industry has been treated since March 2020. And he isn't the only one that is losing a considerable amount of money. Dipchan Prasad, the owner of Passage to Asia, he said he is contemplating closing his operations on Arequipa Avenue, Port of Spain. Prasad said, I'm paying 15,000 plus VAT in monthly rent for the place in Port of Spain. I'm not earning any money. To set up the Port of Spain branch cost me around 1.5 million. And he is paying 105,000 a month in mortgage to the bank for the restaurant at Chagones. And yes, some of these are these men, that was the risk that these men took. And that was the risk they took as businessmen. But the loss of this risk isn't in their lack of work ethic, isn't in their lack of willingness to put out the effort. The loss in this is in the fact that they were shut down and closed. So, okay, if you're saying that the closure is necessary for the country to run, again, if the closure is necessary and they have to be losing thousands and millions of dollars, then how could you be gaining thousands and millions of dollars? And you aren't gaining it by selling any goods, you're gaining it by our tax monies. I don't understand how anyone out there cannot get this. There are still people out there that are willing to excuse this. There's no way this is excusable to me. In the middle of a pandemic, really and truly, I think these tax exemptions should be cut. I don't understand this idea of treating the leaders of a country who are supposed to be in a position to serve us. We hire them to serve us. They are supposed to be serving us. We are treating them as lords. It seems like so many people are addicted to the idea of reverting back to kings and lords. People want someone to worship. I would prefer not to give any worship to a human and not to treat a human like they're better than me. And I'd prefer that these humans not treat themselves like they're better than us also. Anyway, something I've come to notice also is that there's a group of people that lobby for special treatment for the superiors as they see it, and lobby for them to be treated as a class above because they have dreams of once being in that class and being treated as a class above also. So maybe some of the people that attempt to excuse these things are in that class of people, maybe, I don't know. So you tell me, what is the possible reason? Can you give me a reason why the government workers, the MPs, the Prime Minister shouldn't take a pay cut, why this shouldn't stop these tax exemptions? Can someone please articulate to me a clear logical reason why they shouldn't do this? Drop that in the comments for me if you have one, or if you think that they should take a cut and they should cut these tax exemptions, do comment and tell me that also. Don't forget to click the like button if you haven't done that, and if you haven't subscribed, do subscribe, and I'll see you again tomorrow at 10 a.m. for the next video. And you feel the music. Feel the music rising with the tide.